new toy. We started our own little group called AUXCOMM Louisville because we do step a little bit out of the ranges of ham radio completely, because we have we're technology based, we're amateur radio based, and we understand through the AUXCOMM training in Frankfurt that will be available soon. That technology, communications, you could be on any band. So AUXCOMM's the next deal. This is to promote the Jefferson County Search Dog Association. We are a nonprofit. Specialized canine unit. We got several talented dogs, and the group's getting bigger. Ground pounders being some of the most important, but the key point here is each one of our handlers are amateur radio operators. So everybody has their FT60 on their side, everybody has it programmed the same way, and they can use it when they go into the field. Yep, we use dogs and radios. Now the dog types, this is trailing, tracking. Tracking dog follows footsteps of where a person walked, most used by police. Well, Oofta is our tracking dog. Everybody here meet Oofta? Over by the canine thing. Yeah, go meet Oofta. It's outside. Love Oofta. Oofta is a great tracking dog. We had a search, and Bud was about to go on a 7-mile walk. He didn't realize it. But fortunately for Bud, the person that was lost passed out on the sidewalk and somebody called the police. So he didn't have to walk the full 7 miles to that person. But Oofta was right on the trail. Trailing dog. 80% of them are bloodhounds. I think there's even a search group that has bloodhounds that does a really good job. Air scent is a dog we use. They track through their, I don't know the exact,
they smell good.
They smell good, yeah. If you have perfume on, they'll catch you. but no, they're really good dogs. Of course, we've got the human remains detection dog. You never say that in search and rescue. You're in front, in communications or otherwise. When you're transmitting or not transmitting, or you're talking to another person, you never use human remains detection or anything that says dead person detection dog. Because you have a family that's around, and you have to be very cognizant of what you're saying on the radio, because believe it or not, they're trying to listen almost as intently as you are. And so you don't want to say damn dog or anything. But we use HRD for that. I can't really go over this. Bud gave me this, so I can't really go over this like much. I do know that Bud collects a lot of scent articles in his searches. He's got a lot of weird stuff in one of the rooms of his house you don't want to go into. And don't ever open up one of his freezers, please. because that's how they train the dogs. They actually have human parts that they train with. But one of the things we respond to is natural disasters, man-made disasters, drownings. A natural disaster, I think everybody here was probably or near or working the Henryville and West Liberty. So we were there too. Man-made disasters, that's becoming a higher probability every day, it seems like, unfortunately. Drownings, we did that, the 9 people on the Ohio River on July 4th that tipped over, and they lost, I believe, 4 people on that one. And Once in a while, we'll get called to a forensic crime scene, but we don't show up in force. Just usually just one dog, one handler, and so we don't send anybody out there. And this is just an opportunity that, yes, this is where amateur radio comes in. The reason we do what we do is helping others in disasters. That's a picture of my son. If we had a little bit of flooding, certain areas of Louisville got flooded, and an apartment complex got flooded, so I made them spend their weekend passing out bleeding kits. Both of them are amateur radio operators, and it's annoying when your dad's on the radio with you saying, "I'm around the corner," you know, so. So there's actually ways when you're helping the Red Cross that you can use communication with amateur radio too, and just simply going around passing out kits. But, okay, communications, that's usually between setting in the trailer or setting up your station, and then talking to the people in the field. Trackers, APRS, everybody here familiar with APRS? That's, I love it. I mean, APRS is awesome. I could actually use APRS, take that information, and we've actually done, I do screenshots of it sometimes and put it to Word as we're doing it, kind of documenting the search. We can also keep it as a running log if somebody really wanted to go through and watch everything for hours. But we have that also. We just recently, the boat drowning, we had to give some information to a lawyer. They requested that information. So this is what they got too. So we use handhelds and mobiles. Mostly handhelds when we get to the scene. Mobile radios are usually the go kit that you set up at the scene, or now the communications trailer. That's what I like. I love watching the maps. I love being able to see the people. Seeing the people in the field is awesome because you know where they're at. If they say they give you the coordinates, you can actually check if they're correct. And if they find a clue, that's, you can also mark that down, because in your radio log you want to mark down where they found the clue, where they found the candy wrapper, because we have people that actually question the family about almost everything about the person. So if they like a certain candy bar, we see that wrapper, we collect it. All-in-one trackers. You didn't bring any of the wheels. Oh, there's one right there.
Yes, there is.
Yeah.
Okay. I need to know how to use this. Like.
Oh, yeah, all-in-one. Yes, you're sitting right next to the perfect man for that.
What does this do?
I have no idea.
Does this break off?
Yes. Let me show you. What SAR track software is most people using right now? I'm starting to use the SAR track. SAR track is really neat program. There is a learning curve to it, but SAR track, you can eliminate people out of the scene. So if you have like a bunch of amateur radio operators there with their APRS on, but you didn't want to see them, you just want to see the people in the field, you can eliminate them off the string. So it allows you to filter that out. SAR track has that capability, and it is very nice. I use View 32. I've used it. I love that program also. But SAR track is supported, and if you download it, I suggest sending them $15-$20, you know, some appreciation there, because they're continually updating it. It is one of the best that we have out there right now, and it is actually a full suite for a search team, because you can set up a database and everything else. So it's actually really, really nice. And it's easy too. It's not complicated. Even I can set it up. I mean, somewhat. But weather stations, that's another neat thing APRS is used for. And you can set up a weather station. Don't have one in the trailer yet, maybe one day. But okay, communication setup. One of the biggest things is weather location. I don't get the luxury of having a station already laid out for me when I arrive. I don't get the luxury of electricity sometimes, or even a generator. Sometimes it's, you're over there in this middle of the field, that's what you get, that's how you set it up. So you get your GoPro, you get the batteries, if you got a generator, great. If you don't, you know, you just go battery. And one of the key factors in search and rescue in any disaster where you have a lot of people that are affected by the disaster, headphones, I recommend them greatly, because I always go away from the family. I don't want to see the family. I don't want to see the people that are affected by the disaster. That's really not my job. My job is to get them help. So I try to stay away from the family, the victims, and go off to the side, have my headphones on. They can't hear me, hear somebody come across the radio saying, we found somebody injured here, you know, so we don't have 50 people running to that location. So I've learned to use headphones a lot. seat, you may have one, you may not have one. I always suggest always bringing your own, having a phone in there. Cones, I always, because amateur radio operators, we have wires everywhere, and no matter how hard you try to put those wires to your station without interfering with other people, they will find them and trip on them. So just bring cones, tape, whatever. I usually bring a computer. Sometimes I have internet. Sometimes I'm just using IU32 or SAR track, whichever one you prefer, an APRS. And you can have a paper radio log. Now, if I'm just sitting up on a table in the middle of nowhere and I don't have the trailer, I'm more likely going to be using a paper radio log because the computer's going to be tied up with APRS and other things. A notepad, you got to have something to write down information. The coordinates, when somebody's needing something, you definitely need a notepad on the side. This is one of our searches, and that's kind of how it most of the time kind of looks like. I mean, you've got the kit, you got the radios, you got the laptop, you even got the little light, the little notepad, Android notepad there. Lost person behavior has a program, I don't know if you guys know this, that you can get on Google Play. It's $9.99. It's $10, and it tells you where the proximity possibilities and the statistical type stuff where maybe an Alzheimer's patient or somebody was hiking and that type of thing. We also in JCSEA, we have National Weather Chat that we watch. We watch the weather also on the computer. If I'm not looking at APRS, I'm looking at weather. If I only have one computer, those are the two things I'm looking at all times. On a good day and I don't have to worry about weather, I don't pay attention to it as much, but right there, that's really, I like the 710. I still haven't found too much of a radio that does better than that, even with the fusion stuff. This, am I wrong?
Best one.
What? Best one, yeah. I still can't find, I mean, even with the new fusion and all, it does all this great, it does great.
So here. Much easier with that than the fusion.
Yes. Very much so. Absolutely. I agree. Absolutely. I got two of them. I'm planning on buying a third. They're just so easy to use. You plug them up. Almost intuitive in how you do it. And once you start learning the radio itself. This is kind of your APRS when you're on the internet. It looks watchy. But it kind of gives you an idea of what the screen looks like. SAR track, like I said, you can actually do filtering, so you can see only the ones you want to see. that helps. This also shows right here the different tracks our search teams go. We take a picture, Well, this is the actual UI 32, and you can see where they're searching, where they're at, where they're looking. Worst thing in the world if you want to send somebody out there and you lose your team.
That happens.
It's a little embarrassing, you know, search team, or lose a team, you don't want to do that. So we have this, you know, I mean, and it helps. And I've, even in the woods, I usually still get a real decent, with the all-in-one trackers that we have. We get that.
James, come back and back in one. The reason I gave James is because you guys in emergency management, you kind of get appreciation of this. This is a night when they had a very large outbreak of earthquakes. This is actually faster than any notification I've gotten regarding earthquakes. Distance, longitude, latitude of the epicenter. It's very rapidly. The Weather Service, U.S. Geological Survey, National Park Service, I mean, there's all these entities that tie into this system. So I can see a mudslide in California. I can see the fires that are going on in California, and I can see the fires going on in, Alaska, where I actually had, I had a friend up there running APRS off that did run a dog race, and I said, why do you have fires in the middle of wintertime and they're still there? He goes, because they're underneath the ground still burning. Just when it thaws out, it'll start back up again, so we need to know where they're at. So as emergency managers, you can really get a concept of a lot of the disasters. It'll show the tornadoes popping up, the warnings, and they'll send a little alarm off, say, you know, you're in the warning area, watch area, and that way I can at least pull the resources out of the woods or just leave them in their place. So that's what you're actually seeing there is earthquakes, I think, off the coast of,
And what system is this with?
That's the APRS and SARTRAC will do both those. They're just tapping into the National Weather Service on the U.S. Geological Survey.
I'll talk with you later. I can't hear from them.
Okay, yeah.
Hey, Jeff, yeah, thanks.
Okay, what does ham radio allow us to do? We can respond to any county and establish communication with Emergency Operations Command or Command Post. When we set up for a search, we're usually pretty much me and the team, but then the Emergency Operation Command is, of course, talking to Bud, and I'm the guy behind the radio. I'm just getting the information back and forth. But we're set up to respond with a trailer, a smaller operation. We can actually expand out to multiple locations for relay stations now. We have the capability of probably 2 or 3 portable operating systems other than the trailer in a wide area disaster now. So we can cover a large area now. We even have the, and it's coming up, but we're going to show you. I don't want to tell you about it until we get there. It's kind of neat. That's what I started with, an old radio, an FTA 800, and of course the Kenwood 710. You gotta have that.
Old radio. Well, that's hard. I've got a brand new one in the box I just got.
Oldie but good.
Because I feel about the 8800 the way you did with the 710. You know,
yeah.
If I can afford a truckload of them to stockpile.
Yes. I can't complain about the 8800. I love it. I mean, I've got 3. No, actually 4. And the Bearcat 96, if you let MetroSafe program it, it's really garbly. You can't understand it. I don't know why. So we got our, that. So what we did is we got an 800 megahertz radio in the trailer, and it's receive only. And it's also transmit on the ATAC channels, on the interoperability channels. We can transmit on the interoperability. Mostly we use it to listen in, situational awareness type thing. Got to know what's happening around you. You're not in an isolated incident. You're part of a larger incident, so know what's going on. that was my first, one of my first builds. I answered my first build. We didn't have these fancy little gator cases. Power Works, power supply, power poles, must have. Don't go leave home without them. Have the crimpers with you, because I promise you one of the red wires will go bad when you don't need it to.
And there's a review in the September QST of a really, really nifty little portable voltage and current monitor that just plugs in line with power poles. And it's like 20 bucks. And I think it hooks over radio that's got it. But it's, I've seen a demo, and it's on my, I've got to make my list to order here by the end of the month.
You're getting smart now.
Or, it's a current voltage and something else, and it just cycles through. It's powered by the circuit. And the other downside is I think the leads are about either 14 or 16 gauge wires, so you don't want to hook your 100 watt mobile up and key down for a long time.
Yeah.
But for a small go kit, it's fantastic, because instead of having to build in this great big monitor or be clueless about the state of your battery power, it's just a little tiny size of a thumbnail gadget. It's great.
They also, eBay, they have a relay switch. It's for $21 on eBay, and it's power poles.
Yeah.
And I ordered that. I'll tell you how that turned out next year or on Facebook. But yeah, I mean, these things are power poles, Anderson poles, love them. I mean, don't leave home without them. That was my little nerd van. Got it real cheap, hollow shelving. I still have it. It's actually going to try to get rid of it. It had some mechanical issues. It had mechanical issues when I first got it. it was just basically for search and rescue only. It held all my equipment and everything that I needed when I got there. So, and as you move on and up and you get better ideas and thoughts, henceforth the trailer now. But, this is a move up, big time. This is a UHF repeater. We now have, it's out there on display. It has the same Power Works that the other kid had, if you notice that thing. It's actually the same one. It has the transmit, receive, and what do they call itinerant channels. We have them programmed in, one without, no PL, and this was given to us and created Dave Whittle and Ken, AC4G, they worked on building this out for us, and Bars Club donated it, and the repeater itself. It is, you set it up, you have a full-fledged UHF repeater on site. Go to a high location, get better coverage. We have PL tone, without PL tone. It's also set up for SAR. So we got infield communications. Kind of excited about getting to use this. I want to see what we can do. It's got a little switch there, if you notice that. They put that in, you hit a little button, you flip that switch, and it gives out a phrase, and that phrase tells everybody to come back home. So that was our come home. We're done, boom. Everybody comes back home. So one way we can use, so we don't tell everybody and their brother over VHF or UHF that we have found them or how we have found them or anything. We just call everybody home, they know what the phrase is on the team, they get back there, and then we can discuss it. So this is really, really, really neat. Appreciate the Bars Club, Dave Whittle, and Ken for doing this. This was super. Now, this brings the relay switch I got from eBay up, is batteries. I have a little power pole where it's just set up plug the two batteries in, slap it in, and I got power. Now I can slap the battery in. I got a relay switch. It will immediately switch over once I lose AC power if the generator goes bad or there's no electricity. Now that right there is power. Thank the state of Kentucky, Meade County, Ron. That's beautiful. My hope is we can help a lot of people with that. We can keep up and going. And that we can be in there for the long haul. Hopefully we never have to use it for that. But that's why we made it. Right? Uh-oh, what happened?
I hear a lot on my searches from James.
you would hear nothing if you weren't there. So.
Yeah, so at least you're hearing something.
Yeah. You'd be happy you're hearing something. That means you have
comments. Uh-oh. Yeah.
We held down at Powell County a few weeks back when they had that long extended operation trying to find that guy.
Me and Robert were on that one. Yeah, that was excellent.
I wanted to be.
Yeah. I got to talk to some of the guys from Powell County and was explaining to them what ham radio could do for them as far as the digital aspects of it, the crossband repeat. They thought, they've never heard anything like that. So Aries wants to try to get the word out to where the local ham operators, especially Aries groups, can work with individual SARs. You know as well as I do, in a lot of those areas, you move 2 feet, you'll have communications, move another 2 feet, and you have nothing. But, if we can take, like, crossband repeat and set a vehicle up on top of a ravine, we got many.
Yeah, since, Robert, I'll get to you in a second, but, on that one, it was a very good exercise. Yeah. We, after 10:45, were the only team communicating. All my guys are ham radio operators. We have our trackers and all that kind of stuff going on. They tried something that the UHF, VH, I'm sorry, VHF, see, UTAC, UTAC channels. We're on UTAC.
Oh, you guys.
Because we had the repeater set up.
Yeah.
That was a problem because they really didn't comprehend communication. Yes, they're good rescue squads, okay? But we had 42 agencies at once happening. Okay, there's a difference between, hey, two rescues Powell and Wolf County, they're really great teams, they know their stuff, okay? But then all of a sudden you had 42 agencies coming in there. They had multiple frequencies. The repeater failed on that one because they basically put the repeater at command post with a 5-watt, the 5-watt radio talking 20 feet away, and all of a sudden they send them miles downhill. That was an error site on everybody's part because you just don't think. I was like, okay, let's put the repeater there. I ended up myself just not searching and leaving command post and doing a relay. I basically took my 8800 and used it as a relay, either from my team to my vehicle, or either crossband between their ham frequency to the. To the repeater or back to the command post is the way we communicated. Yes, it tied up an 8800 and in the middle of the woods, but at least they had communications.
Yeah, that's what they're here for.
We had communications. I'll be a man. I've been using and abusing hams for a long time, guys. We cannot function more than 29 hours, and that's because I've dumped a lot of money into batteries. 29 hours is not a long time to think about it. That's a day and a little bit. And that means we max out our battery. We just can't carry that much battery power with us. So yes, I do use and abuse ham radios.
Carry a little bit more now.
You also look at gas. James only looks at, if you can key the mic, I look at consumption of battery, consumption of fuel, so I'm going to have to look at this. That search is a really good example because we really could have used communications better on that one because they were using their commercial band stuff and the Bofang radios.
Bofang.
They did fail. It took.
They vary. Some of them work great. Some of them.
Yeah, you got the nicer model, but the real ones.
UV5R.
they're chew toys for my dogs, okay, guys? I'm not cutting down Bofang by any means, but they're good radios when I'm on the water, when I'm knowing I'm going to drop it in the water and any drownings. And if I know that I'm going to drop this in, it's a disposable radio for me. I'm sorry, but you know, it sounds kind of weird, but
it is.
It is. It's a disposable
radio.
Sadly,
too many people are adopting them as their everyday radio.
Yeah. You know, we switch with it. We stay with the Yaesu military spec radios because, one, they're going to chew up. You know.
The biggest single problem that we run into with, and I'm, like I said, I've become a big fan of the latest version of Bofang QB82C, is because it actually is a legally certified radio. Yaesu and AUXCOMM and Kenwood simply will not sell a FCC type accepted radio or certified radio in which a VFO can be activated in any shape, form, or fashion. Even though that's not exactly what Part 90 requires, it just can't be the default option, but they don't want to cannibalize their commercial sales. You know, I mean, they don't want to cross between their ham lines and their commercial lines. And part of the problem is we get into situations where people have to do that thing where you drop your ham rig and that little resistor that tells it where the band limits are pops off the circuit board mysteriously. That's great right up until the point where something goes wrong and you get that $10,000, you know, Christmas gift from the FCC, except it's going to them. So part of the reason, you know, speaking from purely the public safety side, part of the reason the Bofangs are so popular is that they make models that are actually FCC type certified or legal for commercial and public safety use, and with computer programming, can be the VFO can be reenacted, and that's, you know, if Kenwood, I mean, I've got a half dozen Yaesus and love them. But the latest version of the Bofang is scary good for the price. I mean, it's not quite Kenwood and Yaesu yet, but it's scary good for what you pay for it. Kenwood and Yaesu are going to have to step up the game if they want to stay, you know, the top dogs in the field. There's no contest for ham use. I mean, if you want to sit there in the shack and do all sorts of bells and whistles, you know, the Kenwoods and AUXCOMMs and so forth, they've got it. But for field use, like them or not, you're going to be, it's just like the Glock. It's the ubiquitous police sidearm now because it's cheap and it works. These are cheap and the latest versions actually work remarkably well. So you're going to see a lot of them. The biggest thing is they will overheat if you key them a lot. And I think that's a feature that makes my guys shut up.
Back to your point of hands being involved, that's the whole idea of what I wanted to bring Chris or James in for, is to say how hams can play a role in all SAR units. There are a lot of SAR units that don't even know ham radio operators exist.
That's a real problem because of interoperability.
We need to approach them.
And that's what we need. We need, with you guys to work with, we need to be introduced to other agencies, other SAR agencies. Like I said, I made contact with the Powell County down there, just walked up and started talking to them at a festival that was down there.
Okay, yeah.
And, you know, explained to them what we could do with cross-band repeat, like you said. Explained to them about the new stuff coming out, the fusion stuff, where the handhelds have APRs built right into them. They said, look, you can track your people, basically.
Yeah.
Really? And they didn't know any of this. So, I mean, it's, we need, as hams, we need your all's help to get the word out to these other groups of what we can do. We're not afraid to go talk to them. By no means.
Yeah.
But we need to be able to get that handshake out there and say,
yeah, I mean,
talk to these people.
I mean, like I said, I'm not joking. I've used and abused hams, okay? I've used them on long-range disasters, where I'm talking from Florida to Louisville. I'm getting DWIs or disaster welfare inquiries, what do I call them now, welfare inquiry checks, whatever. You know, so the long-range guys, the HF guys, that's why I've kind of charged James with, is because I'm not happy with the EchoLink system. And it's a good, cute system, but when you're talking straight up HF to HF in an EOC operation, that's priceless to me. Because one, now I can tell the Emergency Operations Center, I've got five dogs here, I've got four dogs in this county, and two in this county. I mean, now they know where I'm at. You know, repeaters are great, so we do piggyback on you guys a lot. But there's others, like I said, there's a lot of SAR teams I'm just now forcing them to say, you got to at least sign a VTAC thing. You at least need to get some minimal communications. There are people out there still using FRS radios, thinking that's the way to go. And I'm thinking, no, you don't want to do that. I'll tell you a quick funny story about FRS radios. FRS radios, family radio systems, okay? We were doing a grounding down in Washington County, I believe. The dog handler keeps them like, we have something called a PAR, which is a personal accountability report. Basically, I'm PAR 2, one dog, okay? He goes, PAR 2, one dog, can you bring another dog to check my, just check it out, because I think I've located somebody, found something. And I geared up, got my dog ready to go, and got out there, and I said, oh, give me your location. And the gentleman goes, I got a PAR 23, one dog.
Okay.
And I'm going, PAR 2, one dog. And I'm going, PAR 23, the family had the radios, family radio systems. All the family heard was they may have located them, they came out there, and ever since then, I have not touched an FRS radio since then.
Henceforth, even an amateur radio, you got to train people when they're around the command post, turn it down.
Yeah, because the bottom line is after the family got a backhoe guy, it was a back washer before the water came up and flooded. It was a porta potty. You know, the dogs would detect on human remains. Well, theoretically, a pile of poop is human remains. So it was underneath rubble. So, but that's something that we needed to check out. That's all he said. You know, the dog just basically it body there the usual alert, but something remains like that. It's like, hey, you know what? This is something kind of going to check out a little bit. But it wasn't an emergency for the whole family, the coroner. You just kind of go check your math out. You know, and that's one of the biggest problems with FRS radios. We haven't touched them since then. Now, do you have FRS on the trailer?
No.
We can talk
you
on
should,
it.
Though.
Actually, what they would be good for is like on a scene around there is giving them to different people that maybe don't have a license.
Yeah.
And being able to contact, say, I need you to come here, I need you to come there. But
yeah, as far as logistics.
Yeah,
logistics, yeah.
Basically.
Yeah.
We just put them on a big bit that they're both hanging on a business frequency.
Exactly. You know, $50 a pop, if they don't bring them back, you know, you can live with it.
I got 2 for $30.
Yeah, but probably not the commercial.
Yeah,
it works.
Well, I hate to keep interrupting. A couple things I wanted to throw out because one of them, I wound up getting back in the areas. Well, Alan and a couple other folks approached me about getting back involved in areas I haven't been involved in for many years. Obviously, I do work in law enforcement. I'm assistant chief for volunteer fire department. I'm training officer for a search and rescue organization. And one of the situations, if you really want to get areas more involved with public safety organizations in general, not just search and rescue, but fire departments, I mean, we have some big grass fires that go for days, you know, woodland fires, we can use the help. But, and this is sort of a pet peeve of mine, and I apologize if a couple of you heard it in other sessions. We have to be willing to meet the public safety agencies where they are. And by that I mean, they don't care that I have an amateur extra license. They care that I'm a communicator. They don't care that, you know, I've got crossband 2 meter 440 repeater with blah blah. All they care is, can you get me in touch with my field team and that help? And so sometimes we have folks in amateur radio, we become a little proud of our licenses, we become a little proud of the fact that we have technical skills. And I once had a ham operator tell me, back in my first involvement with Aries, when people were complaining, well, we don't get enough to do, you know, they never call us out. And I said, well, guys, I can get you probably a call out a month at least, if you know. But you know, this is what they're going to expect. They're going to expect you to show up and know how to operate within the system. You know, now we're seeing ICS training and first aid and CPR training strongly recommended by AFRL for various volunteers. Yeah, at a minimum, if you show up on my scene, I expect that you know those things. The second thing is, they're going to say, we need to communicate with this person here. And they may not care that you've got the nice, you know, 8800 crossband repeat capability in your car. They may hand you a radio on a police frequency or the search and rescue team's frequency or whatever. and say, I need you to take this radio here and the radio of the fire department, because they've got search teams out too, and I need you to relay me on deployments either. So if you approach it from the perspective of, I'm a professional communications person, I'm here to solve your communications problems, I'm not going to tell you how anything should be run. You tell me who you need to talk to and what information you need to get to them. Is it voice? Do I need to send them a picture? Whatever. And I will do my best to make that happen. And if that involves using your radios, my radios, or one we have to go to Walmart and buy from the FRS,
yep,
truck, we'll make it happen. And if you start with that approach, that will win you a lot of friends very quickly. If you start from the approach of, well, you know, I've got all these licenses and, you know, I've got this technical knowledge and you're, you know, we need to do it this way because that's the way hams do it. Trust me, when I put my fire chief hat on, I don't care how hams do it. I care who I need to talk to. Not to be rude, but I mean, I've got bigger problems than them. So if you're there to make that happen, you're my friend.
Also, I think adding on what you're saying, because that's perfectly what the example is,
yeah.
Also vetting your resources.
Yes, make sure.
Because if I show up with Robert, you know, if Robert calls me and comes down to Mass Academy, I call him up to Louisville or something like that, he's going to send me, he may not be able to respond, but he's going to send me people. And if I can call Robert and go,
what am I getting here?
Yeah, what are you sending me? Who are you sending me? What are you sending me? You know, working with emergency management, doing MOUs, mutual of understanding agreements. And if anybody needs copies of these forms, I'm more than welcome to give them to you. All you do is cross off JCSDA and put in whatever. But we do this for our local AUXCOMM guys and things like that. Is basically it's who we are. And then we've kind of gone that one step further now, is because now I get a lot of data and a lot of information about the missing person. Forget HIPAA. Okay, let's talk about decent common courtesy, what can come out of that radio and what can come out of the data. Because ham radios are not just, radio operators are not just a ham radio operator, they're data processors. Whether that's APRS telemetry, whether that's data bursts, whether that's emailing, whatever that communication means is, it's fed into that trailer. I'm starting to vet our people now because, you know, do they have a background check? Do they have a confidentiality clause that says, you know, I'm an ARES member and you're going to give me information about this person that we found deceased because we need to logistically get him out of there. Some of our searches, it was kind of funny, we've had searches that last 11 minutes, 5 hours to get him out of the woods, okay? So this is something that's very confidential is, you know, we don't need ARES or we don't need someone blabbing to the news media to tell the family, you know, the family don't need to hear that this person's deceased until the coroner tells them they're deceased, okay? So there needs to be a certain level of ICS training, obviously, and I think most all areas people will take the 1, 2, 7, and 8. But vetting the members, because if I use ARES, like I called somebody for drowning up in Louisville, James was, why are you gone today? I don't know. The guy got swept away in the river. What was the name?
What?
The guy got swept away in the river by the bridge, new bridge.
Recently?
Yeah. What was this?
You mean that pontoon boat?
No.
That pontoon boat?
No. A guy got swept away in the water. So I called the ARES guy and says, you know, I need a radio operator. You know, says,
oh, this, yeah, it was something to do with my son.
Oh, yeah. Okay, yeah. So, you had a reason. But, you know, it was just on a Saturday morning for a couple hours, and it wasn't, if he wasn't going to be in that area, he was not going to be in that area. If he wasn't in that area, he was basically 70 miles down the river. So it was a flooding came up. All I said was, hey, you know what? I need a radio operator. Very nice. He says, okay, this is what I got for you. And he replied back to me going, what do you need in the way of communications? I like hearing that. And I says, yeah. You know what? I've got an 8800, I can let you have, we go long, we need a crossband. I need you to bring a handheld and enough battery power to last probably 15, 18 hours. The ARES, I tell you guys, it would really help us. I don't know who's ARES and things like that. ARES managers, there's actually something called a mission ready package that emergency management's doing. Just go on emergency management website and find the mission ready package. Just fill the form out it basically says who you are, what your capabilities are, what are you going to consume? Because if you send me an area, if you're going to send me a radio operator, I've got to feed him. I got to make sure he goes potty. Sounds dumb, but I've got to consider if you send me somebody, you know, we're deployments for 3 days. And all of a sudden he shows up with a handheld radio and no batteries. I've got to now feed him, water him, let him go out, go potty. I mean, I've got to basically baby him. So the mission ready package basically will say, I need a type, a NIMS type 2 radio operator. That means he's going to be self-deployed for up to 24 hours with batteries. He's going to become somewhat self-sufficient. He's going to have enough candy bars or Hot Pockets to survive for X amount of hours. The mission ready package is something that I'd like to see Aries really do, like our SAR teams do, is because I can tell right now, you NIMS type 2 SAR team?
I'm not sure at the moment, honestly. Okay. We're just now going through the MRP process because with all the changes that we've had recently, changed our capabilities. So we're just revising everything. I'm not sure exactly where we're going to come out. But
You're also, Madison County also does general rescue.
General rescue.
Auto education. We don't do that, so I have a little less paperwork than he does, so I'm done with it. But that's a perfect example. What you're going to send to us is, we need to know beforehand. You know, what are you going to consume while you're there? And can you be self-sufficient? If I can advise that, I don't know if that's upsetting.
72-hour self-sufficient and deployment.
Yeah.
The MRP, basically, you can think of the mission-ready packaging as kind of like when you go to the store and, you know, whether you're shopping at Ham Radio Outlet or Walmart, you know, you read the package. You know, what's in the package? Do I need to buy batteries separately? Are cables included? And so on. Well, that's exactly what the MRP is, the same thing for a resource, for a team, or a radio operator, or whatever. What's in this package? Well, if I order this package, I get 3 radio operators. All 3 of them come self-sufficient, except for water, for 72 hours, meaning they'll bring their own food, they'll bring their own sleeping bag, whatever. For 72 hours, they'll have batteries or some method of staying on the air for 72 hours. I've got 3 guys here who can work 8-hour shifts around the clock for 72 hours. Okay, great. I need one of those. And it makes it so much simpler because when we're out in the field, we call the state duty officer at the Emergency Operations Center and say, get me blank. And again, unless I need a very specific resource, and I may say, get me Jefferson County Search Dog Association because I know Bud's going to bring James and his 50 trailer. But otherwise, I may say, I need radio communications. You know, I need 3 radio operators for 24/7 for the next 3 days. They'll scroll through their list and see who's available. And if there's more than one package that meets that, who's closest? If there's any cost associated with deploying them, you know, are they going to have to reimburse something? Because obviously, if it's going to cost me to get something, I need to know that. And so on. And that's everything from the commercial hazardous materials cleanup crew that comes in and charges $1,000 an hour to suck up all the green ethyl stuff off the side of the road to volunteer organizations. And so that's it's a great thing. But if you get in that system, that is, and frankly, my hat's off to you, bud, if I had a hat, because I hadn't even thought about that, but that's exactly where, if you really want to get communications deployments around the state, that's exactly where you need to go and start putting together a mission-ready package.
And know what your NIMS typing is.
And you can ask for help. Your local emergency management folks will help you right out on that.
Yeah, just type in NIMS typing, and it will come up with your type. If I say that I want a type five radio operator, he's going to show up with a handheld radio and 2 batteries.
Yep.
If I say I want a type 1, that means he's going to be self-deployed for four days and have a bunch of stuff with them. And they also with teams. James is not ready for that paperwork yet. You know that, don't you?
Well,
your NIMS typing is coming up.
We will. We'll get through it.
And don't play with that for a while.
I'm already thinking what you're saying. And
You have to oversell either. By that, I mean, don't feel like, oh, we have to be at type 2.
Yeah.
If you're comfortable at type 2, 3, or 4, go in as type 3 or 4. But you know, there's plenty of times when all I need is a type 3 or 4. I don't need a type 2. And so I've seen organizations and agencies and individuals struggle to try to push their capabilities to get a better typing categorization. Well, that's great if somebody, you know, if I really need that, but 9 times out of 10, what we do, we go with the least capable resource that will do the job. It's just like in ham radio, use the lowest power, you know, that'll maintain adequate communication. We go with the least intensive resource that will do the job. If I only need a type 4 radio operator, that's what I'm going to ask for. I'm not going to ask for a type 1.
Well, you also have these hams out there that say they can do the job.
And sometimes,
like you said, shows up and has got nothing.
We see that in police work.
And before we went and told our EMA in Shelby County, we tested. We made sure that anything we told them we could do, we could do.
You're Paul.
Huh?
Yeah, I know you are. You're Paul.
Yeah.
I'm talking about we've got a class coming next month.
But one thing Bud mentioned earlier, I did want to reiterate because it is important. Communication security. When I put my ham on and, you know, I'm talking to somebody in Venezuela, I don't care if somebody listens in on the QSO. In fact, you know, by FCC regulation, it's illegal for me to attempt to obscure any of that. But when you're doing tactical communications for a public safety event, you know, that's when, you know, we all know emergency communications, a lot of the rules can kind of get bent. Well, we deliberately will use certain codes. Now, they're in plain English, but they're code words or code phrases that mean specific things. You know, we've located the lost subject, he's okay. We've located the lost subject, he's messed, he's still breathing, but he's messed up, or we've located him and we need a large bag. You know, we don't, none of those do we want to put out exactly that way. So there will be code phrases and code words and so forth. And hams working in areas and working in public safety applications have to get that ingrained, because it's not natural to us as hams to be secretive. But there are times when we have to be in public safety communication, but there's certain things that you can't just put out in the air in plain language, at least not if you ever want to be called back to work a second event.
It's for some nice arm bigger hurts.
Great.
Very informative.
Can touch buttons in the trailer?
What?
Yeah, I thought this was going to include a show and tell.
Oh, yeah.
What are we sitting in here for?
Yeah, we got
this. We're
about 10.
Yeah,
I mean, there actually was a couple people that really were interested.
Oh, really? Yeah.
Yeah, there's somebody.
We actually got
the ones that were asking all the questions, you know, the ones that were.